we're gonna make some Randy's Red for you.
Sweet.
I have mint spark for
you. Okay, okay.
And I also have 4 bubble milk teas and two popcorn chicken.
Yeah, you do. Oh my god.
The bubble milk teas is for you, the rest is for me. I gave you the recipe to Randy's Red.
Yes.
A couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But, so here's the thing, right? Randy's Red technically originally was made with F4 Kona feldspar.
Right.
But Kona feldspar isn't on the market anymore. There's no such thing as Kona feldspar unless you're like an old school potter who has some in their basement. I have 1,000 grams left, but it's really rare and I don't want to spend it. Plus, mint spar is a fine substitute for this stuff, right?
Yes.
So this is mint spar 200. This is the substitute for the F4 Kona feldspar, right? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna put the glaze recipe on screen and down below in the description, and we're gonna make Lindsey a giant bucket of it today.
Okay, so today we're gonna be making Randy's Red, and I'm pretty sure we're gonna be testing this as well. So if you wanna see the results of Randy's Red at the end of this video, stay tuned, that way I can show it to you on white clay, I can show it to you on brown clay, I might even mix it with a couple other things. But this right here is the recipe that we're making, although this is calculated to 1,000 grams, because that's what we're gonna be making in this bucket today. However, I put the actual recipe right here, the way it's supposed to be in its correct proportions. And if you don't feel like reading all that, I put it down in the description below for you like I do with most of my glaze recipes.
Okay.
Why do you have so many, like, why do you have legit, like, 20 pound, 50 pound bags of chemicals?
So these are 50 pounds, so it's, so when I first started making my own glazes, I was trying to figure out what's the most efficient and cost-effective bulk amount to buy, because I make so many, like, of these glazes with these materials throughout the year, that, you know, I can buy a 50 pound bag and it'll last me like 2 or 3 batches for the 4 or 5 glazes that I use the most of. So it's cheaper per pound, and I no joke spent like 4 or 5 hours one time like calculating it, and it was worth the time though. It saves me a lot of money.
Okay, it looks like you have everything ready except for the cake.
Hi, how are you?
EPK kaolin.
That's a lot of kaolin.
That's a lot of kaolin.
Open it.
It's pretty.
You have too much kaolin.
I got exactly the right amount of kaolin.
Oh, wow.
This right here is my favorite thing ever in the history of forever.
Because we don't actually have a graduated cylinder here, we just have a scale and then like this quart bucket, we're gonna have to kind of do it by feel and then measure the glaze later on. But for those of you that are wondering, my preferred gravity for this glaze specifically is 1.4 specific gravity. If any of you out there know how to measure specific gravity, as I heavily suggest you should learn how to measure specific gravity in your glazes, 1.4 is kind of the magic number for me. So we're just gonna keep on adding water until it feels right, and then we're gonna measure it afterwards. We don't have a whisk, but Lindsey just handed me this spatula. She didn't even say nothing. She was just like, oh, here's this, here. Mix it with this.
That's what I always, okay, so normally when I make glazes.
Get a whisk, Lindsey.
That's just how, that's like when I first started working in studios, like we all had like spatulas. That's just kind of, again, what I got used to, so.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay, so Lindsey's gonna dip one of her pieces right now, and this way we can see a test style of it later from her perspective. But after this, we're gonna go to my studio and I'm gonna show you guys the couple of results that I got as well.
That's a 3-second dip. I wasn't quite able to get it, the whole thing in, but once it dries, like you're saying, I'll flip it upside down.
Right, you can just flip, and if you want to, you can even go a little bit past and see it double layered.
Here comes the airplane! Cover, cover, cover!
What are you doing?
When the footwell
is like really deep, I will sometimes end up with little like bubbles like that. So what I normally do is when I'm dipping the bottom half, I'll like kind of jiggle it back and forth to try and break that air bubble, and most of the time gets rid of the spots that are not hit by the glaze.
Right, yeah, that makes sense. Yes. I do that too. I do some of this, like I'll dip it and then let's like, give me the boba.
Get the boba.
Yeah, okay, so like if I dip a cup, I'll usually hold it by the foot and then I'll do like one of these, I'll like gravity it down.
Oh,
and shake it off.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, nowadays I put wax resist on my stuff, but I still, like, still the bottom for some reason is like, what if it, the gravity takes it down? Not today! And so I tip it upside down, and I try and force it upwards up the body of the clay. Okay, so Lindsey just glazed this big pot right here, and this is B-Mix with Grog?
B-Mix with Grog.
Okay, so this is B-Mix with Grog. We're gonna go back to our Dirty Potter studio, and we're gonna go ahead and do it on some white clay, on some brown clay. We'll come back to Lindsey's results, and I will show you my results. Say bye, Lindsey!
Bye!
Okay, Potters, we're back at the original studio that most of the videos are recorded into, and now that we helped Lindsey make her recipe, and we already gave you the recipe on screen, now it's time for me to make my Randy's Red, except for no it's not, because you know I keep a 5-gallon bucket on me at all times. You thought I didn't come unprepared? I thought about this moment before it happened. How dare you? You better click that like button. So Lindsey's gonna be testing hers on B-Mix with Grog in it. We're gonna be testing ours on porcelain, which is this little teacup right here. And then we're also gonna test it on a brown clay, which is redstone from Aardvark. And then we're also gonna be mixing this Randy's Red with a couple of bowls and maybe the Lumos glaze. Usually put a little more effort into these, but these are just two cups I kind of had laying around that happened to be porcelain and red clay. But I would not be surprised if the Randy's Red and Lumos mix came out amazing. I think I've done this combo before and it usually comes out really top 10 lit bet, no cap, no lie, on God, kind of cool. So we're gonna put these in the kiln and I will see you in just a little bit with the results. All right, I just unloaded the kiln. We have some nice daylight going on, so let's go ahead and look at our tests. This is probably one of the better test styles because sometimes Randy's Red comes out like this weird bluish gray if you don't put enough water or enough thickness on it. But usually if you do it just right, if you put it in the bucket and you dip it for about 2 seconds, it comes out just like this, especially on porcelain clay. This is probably one of the better results you're gonna get with Randy's Red because as we've discussed before, Randy's Red usually comes one of about three different colors. It usually becomes completely red, much like this. It becomes a little bit yellow, much like this. Or a large majority of the time, if you haven't gotten the recipe right, or you put too much water, or the gravity isn't high enough, or you haven't dipped it long enough, something where the application is a little bit off, it'll turn like this, this weird grayish blue. It'll turn like this, this kind of like weird grayish blue that nobody wants when they make a recipe called Randy's Red. And on the inside, I started to mix it a little bit with one of my crystal glazes, so you can see on the inside right here that it still does mix with a good portion of my glazes. It works with my Lumos, it works with my clear, it works even with my floating blue. It makes a wonderful glaze combination, but this glaze is pretty good at it. But again, you can still kind of see that fiery reddish yellow that I was talking about even when you mix it with a lighter glaze like one of my crystal glazes. Thank you. This is a perfect test style for this glaze. If I was to give somebody the recipe and they did it exactly how I told them to do it, with the correct specific gravity and everything, this is how it would come out. Now let's take a look at some of the teacups, because they came out relatively similar, although there's one of them that I wanted to show you that basically happened when I was like, well, what would happen if I dipped it for just a second, and I put it in and I dipped it out real quick. So this here are three teacups that I've all dipped with Randy's Red in a different style. While this one looks completely different, these two are basically the same. This one here is dipped for about 2.5 to 3 seconds, the usual dip that I would do whenever I was dipping inside of a giant bucket of glaze. This one here is 2 seconds. And this one is the dip one I was talking about, where I like took it with some tongs and I was like, I dipped it insanely fast. I barely let it soak. So let's take a look at the normal one first to get a good base of what we're dealing with. This is essentially what I showed you earlier on the bowl. This is what Randy's Red usually comes out to when you do it correctly. This one is pretty much pound for pound what I just showed you on the bowl over here. It's you can tell this is the same exact glaze, especially on the inside where it shows more of the yellow fiery red. This is the same glaze. Now let's say you dipped it for the appropriate amount of time. This one's layered a tiny bit, and this one is just usually how I use my Randy's Red. You can definitely tell there's a difference, although they are completely the same glaze. This one's a little tiny bit more red. This one is also the appropriate amount of red for Randy's Red. When I use this glaze, this is what I expect to get out of it. I know I'm really digging in close with the close-ups of this, but I like this because this is like red, 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 a little bit of blue, and then you get this cascade of yellow right here. I don't even know what chemical that yellow is. If somebody in the comments below can tell me, I would love that. It should also be known that when you use this correctly, you will get some variation of this blue. This one was dipped in a little bit less time, as I mentioned before, so you're gonna get some of this blue. The cool thing is, if you wanna do it on purpose, you can. Like, let's say you make Randy's Red, and you like the variation of blue, red, and yellow being all over your pot. You can technically make this glaze like light grayish blue on purpose, but granted, it's very dark. It's kind of like a potter's red, a lot of people describe it as, instead of this kind of true oxidation red like I'm showing you right here. Okay, so this one is the normal one. This is how Randy's Red is generally supposed to be used and how it's supposed to come out as. Now let's take the one that I barely dipped in a glaze bucket and took out immediately. This is the color. It's the same exact glaze, and I know you know, which is why I've been showing you these little bits of blue the entire time in the video. This is what happens when you don't make it thick enough. Although, I do really like this color, and I'm sure there's some people in the comments below who will tell me they like this color as well, but this is not really the gravity Randy's Red should be at, or the amount of thickness that you should apply to Randy's Red in order to get a glaze that turns red. The good news about Randy's Red is also that usually it turns red on the inside of a product, and I'm heavily assuming, I don't know if it's true, that it's because the inside of your products are usually a little bit hotter, which results in a little bit more of the iron coming out in the glaze matrix. So because of that, the entirety of this teacup is pretty much red on the inside, while the outside stayed this nice kind of Randy's Red off blue. And I do understand that's a long way to walk to test out a glaze recipe, but I really wanted you to understand the difference in between a heavily layered, a normally layered, and an underlayered, or at least an overly a correct and an undersaturated glaze when it comes to Randy's Red. This glaze is very finicky, and you can basically get like 3 or 4 different glazes out of it with the difference in application and controlling your gravity or the amount of water in your glaze, as I've specified here. It's the reason why I'm putting them really close to each other, so you can see like this kind of bright yellow, true red, and then weird blue that are all technically the same glaze. Okay, now that we're done messing around with the white textiles, let's look at the brown textile. Surprisingly enough, Randy's Red actually comes out pretty good on brown. Now here's the thing, and this is just a guess, okay? The high majority of clay bodies that are from brown clay already have iron in them. And because of that, you're essentially adding more iron to the glaze. Theoretically, mind you, I don't know that for sure. I'm not a scientist, I'm just really experienced with this glaze. Because of that, regardless of the amount of thickness I put on any brown clay body, it usually turns this darker, deep kind of red that you're seeing right here. That being said, it's very difficult on brown clay to turn it that type of blue that I was showing you earlier on the other teacups with white clay and Randy's Red like this. I almost never get this color on a brown or red clay body. I almost always get Randy's Red, although it's usually a darker, more muted Randy's Red. I almost never get this type of bright Randy's Red that you see here. So it's very stable, especially on brown clay. I do like it like this, but I will say also it does get rid of the bit of variation you would get with Randy's Red. Like, I showed you these three teacups, remember? And there's like three different shades of Randy's Red right here. But when I show you this, although I didn't do any other brown textiles, I'm willing to bet it's gonna come out like this almost every single time. There's a tiny bit of variation when you look down here. It tries to turn that blue that I had mentioned earlier, but it doesn't really do it. Instead, it just gets super dark to the point where you can't tell it's that grayish blue. You can only guess. But especially in this texture, it turns real nice and iron saturated red. Okay, we've checked out what it does on white and brown test styles. Most of those were porcelain, although some of them were B-mix. I do have a B-mix one right here if anybody wants to see it, but me showing you the B-mix test style and then showing you the porcelain test style are so close together that, like, why? They're both the white clay bodies that you guys like to play with, so I don't really care to show one over the other. It's pretty much both white clay. Granted, don't think I'd be holding back information on you. If it was important, I would show you, but I have enough experience with this glaze to be like, it comes out the same. It comes out exactly the same. There's no reason. Now, this glaze combination came out fantastic. Lumos and Randy's Red is one of my favorite glaze combinations, and you're about to see why right now. So you can very clearly still see the Randy's Red is present there, but when it's combined with Lumos, although it does drip a little bit, it makes this type of white, iridescent, runny glaze. It's almost like a drippy glaze, but it's way more uniform than a drippy glaze. This is one of my favorite glaze combinations, and of course, also for consistency. Well, I mean, to be honest with you, it's for consistency and the fact that these are probably gonna go on my website store pretty soon, like right after this video. So if I put these up, I want them to be a set. I usually sell my bowls in sets just like this, right? But as far as consistency goes, I pretty much got the same exact result you would get on another test style. I didn't want to test it and be like, oh, it came out different on another way. It came out the exact same on its smaller counterpart. You can see where it tried to run away. You can see right there. So it does definitely drip a little bit, but the drip is a little more uniform. Usually when you see drippy glazes, it's just like running for its life to get down to the kiln shelf. But like in this situation, usually Lumos, it doesn't do it that much. It just kind of like runs a little and stays together very strong. A little potter tip for anyone planning on using this glaze combination while putting it together, because I technically have given you both glaze combinations on this YouTube channel so far in this playlist. You might want to dip it a little bit into the Lumos after mixing it really well. Like, dip your Randy's Red all the way, right? To maybe 2.5 seconds, take it out, let it dry, and then if you're going to use Lumos, take the bowl, mix it up real well, dip, take it immediately out. Like, don't leave it in there and go read a magazine and like go make some eggs for yourself and go tuck the baby in and then take it out and it comes out of the kiln running and then be like, oh my God, I made it too thick. Of course you made it too thick. You left it in there too long. And Lumos has a high amount of lithium in it. So you got it, like it's gonna run. Lindsey! We're here to check out the, whoa, don't take off your mask.
Why?
Every single time someone takes their mask off around me, this weird song plays and I don't know how to get rid of it. Yeah, nope, just.
What?
Yeah, you should probably leave your, don't. Percocet, Miley Percocet. Happens every time.
But what?
And the more your mask comes off, the more, don't take. Mask on, fuck your mask on. Yeah, you should probably just keep your mask on.
Yeah.
Look at that came out pretty good. Tell us what you think about this color here.
Oh man, okay, so as a textured glaze, it's gorgeous. I love that you're basically getting three different colors. You get where the texture is the highest and the sharpest, you get that lighter color showing the clay body underneath.
Yeah.
Then you have this like blue, gray, ice blue, dark blue combo, and then you get the red and gold. So I guess technically it's what, like eight different colors,
right,
but it's awesome.
A bunch of different colors.
Yeah. I'm more specifically interested in having like, I love this dark red. If I could get this dark red all over the place, that would be my jam, and Dante's gonna help me figure out how to do that.
Yeah, so I technically know how, so if you look in the inside of the mug, you can see it's like pure red, and hopefully it's getting it with the sunlight here, but that pure red is pretty easy to get if you put on a hold on your kiln or a slow cool. I like this red, I'm super down with this red, but I will also fully admit that I really like this blue texture right here.
Mm-hmm.
See this? This happens on like a lot of the texture of Randy's red. Mm-hmm. And I'm so down for it because in my brain it's like, cool, I got two glazes for the price of one.
Yeah. Now how does the specific gravity of the glaze impact what colors tend to show up?
You have more red iron oxide in one specific spot if you have it at a certain gravity. It's less watery, it's more condensed than dispersed out of. So technically speaking, the higher the specific gravity within a glaze, the more of the mineral you will get within any specific surface of that vessel. So like you're getting more red iron oxide in this space here because there's less water and more mineral. Like you're getting more of the mineral that the glaze is made out of in a certain surface area of your pot.
Yeah, okay. So if this was a lower specific gravity, what would we see?
You probably see a lot more of this blue.
Okay.
I think I just did a video on it where I showed a test style of like the blue and the red and they were the same glaze. And this blue here is what usually happens when you have a lower specific gravity. Let me just see it real quick. Let's get a good close up on this. Well, thank you, Dirty Potters, for joining us today. I just wanted to give you guys this recipe. I know I haven't been giving you guys a lot of glaze recipes recently. I've been doing a lot of glaze reviews for Amoco because they're a sponsor of the channel. And thank you to Lindsey.M.Dillon. If you want to see any of her artwork, the links are always down below, as well as my links for your beautiful potter eyes to see. The website, her Etsy, where you can buy some of her stuff, you can buy some of my stuff. But most importantly, don't forget to check out our new podcast, The Mud Peddlers, in which both Lindsey.M.Dillon and I are hosts of, where we basically talk about ceramic art and then make fun of you for about 30 minutes at a time.
I don't know if I'd entirely say that's true, Dante, but we do definitely get into the many different elements that go into being a...
Throw your gifting grip away!
It's one of many options, Dante! This is basically how the podcast goes. Dante says some and then I go, no, wait, slow your roll.
Not slowing the roll!
Anyway, we think you'll enjoy it. Have a listen.
Yeah.
We're on Spotify now.
Yeah, we somehow ended up on Spotify, which I don't know how, because I don't think we put ourselves on Spotify.
No, I thought we had to, and then it just showed up, and we're like, cool, that's less work for us.
I think enough of you listened to it to where Spotify was like, we're just gonna take that. Thank you.
Thank you, Spotify, for making my job easier.
Yeah, technically speaking. So thank you, Dirty Potters, for joining us today. Good luck with your next art projects, and I will see you guys next week.
Cheers. It satisfied my inner Pride and Prejudice loving self.
I just watched Pride and Prejudice.
Which one, the BBC version or the Keira Knightley version?
Wait, what does BBC stand for in your mind?
But it's the British. The British
British something.
Oh, no, I watched
BBC.
No, I watched a different BBC.
Oh, no.